few years ago, we posted a video about making our own maple syrup, as well as the science behind maple sap. And in response, we've received a number of questions about the process. But one question in particular has stuck with me ever since. And so this year, while preparing to tap our trees yet again, I decided it was about time we finally got to the bottom of it. So in this video, we'll attempt to discover whether or not collecting maple sap hurts the tree. But if you haven't already, I'd first encourage you to check out that original video for some background information. So as usual, I've placed a link in the description. But for everyone else, here's a really quick recap. Throughout the year, maple trees produce carbohydrates, or sugar, through the process of photosynthesis. Now, they do this because, like us, trees use carbohydrates as fuel, which they circulate throughout their bodies suspended in water. And also like us, whatever fuel doesn't get used right away gets stored for future use. So by the end of the summer, once the weather turns cold, all of that sap collects in the trunk and roots, where it eventually freezes as the tree goes dormant for winter. Then in the spring, as the below zero nights turn to above zero days, the warming sap expands back up into the branches, where it's used to produce new leaves and get the whole process started all over again. So when we drill a tap hole, we're actually creating an opening for some of that expanding sap to escape. But if sap is essentially food for the tree, doesn't stealing some of it cause a problem? Well, from my research, most seem to agree that the tree already produces more sap than it needs. So as long as we don't take too much, it shouldn't result in any major lasting effects. However, that still leaves the tap hole itself. Because I must admit, it does feel a little unnerving drilling into the side of a living organism. But to understand whether or not it's actually a problem, I think we'll have to dig a bit deeper and talk about some tree anatomy. So first of all, we're all familiar with the growth rings that can be seen on a freshly cut log, branch, or stump. Each of these represent a year of the tree's life. So by counting them, we can accurately determine the tree's age. And by examining their appearance, we can even deduce the kind of weather conditions it experienced throughout the seasons. For example, wider rings typically indicate warm years with above average rainfall, because the extra water and sunshine allowed the tree to put on extra growth. But you'll also notice that the rings on the inside of the tree tend to be quite a bit darker than those on the outside. And that's because as the tree grows older, the cells that make up the earliest rings actually die. And when they do, chemicals are released that make them stronger but also change their color. This is called the heartwood. And don't worry about the fact that it's technically dead. This is a normal, healthy part of a tree's growth and stability. Think of it almost like the tree's skeleton. And then on the outside of the heartwood, you'll also notice lighter colored rings, which are typically referred to as the sapwood. These are the cells that are still alive. And as the name suggests, they're responsible for the transport of water and stored sap up the tree. Think of them almost like the tree's veins and arteries. And finally, there's the outermost ring, right below the bark. This is called the cambium, and it's the part of the trunk that's not only still living, but also still growing. You see, this ring is constantly generating new sapwood cells on the inside, and bark cells on the outside, which means that it's responsible for creating every growth ring all the way back to the beginning. And for that matter, it's responsible for every future growth ring as well. So without the cambium, tree trunks could never grow wider. And as you'll see in a moment, they could never fully heal themselves either. Okay, so that's all of the relevant parts that you can see in a cross-section. But there is one more important structure that I should mention as well. These are called the ray cells. And though they're not always visible to the naked eye, they extend out from the center of the trunk in varying lengths. But for our purposes, let's simplify them a bit and just say that they divide the rings into wedges, almost like the slices of a pie. All right, I think that's enough anatomy for now. When we drill into the trunk of a maple tree, we're essentially severing the individual cells of the sapwood. And so all of that nutrient-rich water quickly begins to escape from the openings. But again, does this hurt the tree? Well, I guess that depends on what you mean by hurt. For example, trees obviously don't have a nervous system, and they aren't sentient or conscious, so it's unlikely that they feel pain or experience anything like suffering. However, it's still pretty clear that this does cause some physical damage. So in that sense, the tree has obviously been injured. But luckily, like any other organism, the tree also has the ability to recover from it. For example, this is a tap hole that we drilled last year, and as you can see, it's already nearly sealed up. But the tree isn't healing itself in the same way that my finger does when I accidentally poke it with a thumbtack. there are some similarities, but as you'll see, there are some pretty big differences, too. For instance, my blood cells quickly clump together to form a clot, keeping the blood loss to a minimum. And once that clot dries out, the resulting scab forms a physical barrier to keep bacteria and other contaminants at bay. And the tree has a similar function, because eventually, once the spile and bucket are removed, the sap begins to gum up the severed cells above and below the tap hole. This helps to prevent additional sap loss, and is also the first line of defense against invading fungus and bacteria. More on them in a moment. So, the first stages of healing are surprisingly similar. But while my finger quickly begins to repair damaged tissue and fill in the wound with new cells, the tree has an entirely different strategy. Because thanks to the cambium, trees are really good at growing new cells on the outside. But unfortunately, they don't have the ability to repair or grow new cells on the inside. So instead, trees rely on a process called caudate, or the compartmentalization of decay in trees. The first step of compartmentalization is that gumming up of the cells above and below the wound. These form the top and bottom walls of the compartment, and help to stop the spread of decay up and down the trunk. Next comes the back wall, which is actually just the outermost undamaged growth ring. This helps stop the spread of fungus and decay further into the center of the tree. And then we have the ray cells, the ones that divide the tree like the slices of a pie. They form the side walls and help prevent decay from progressing around the trunk. And finally, the front wall is created by the cambium. Because remember, it's the only part of the trunk that can actually generate new cells. So it slowly seals up the wound from the outside. This is the strongest line of defense, and it prevents any new fungus from entering the tree. But unfortunately, it also takes by far the longest. Like our tap holes from a year ago that are still sealing up today. So a year or more is a pretty long time for the tree to be exposed. And to make matters worse, those inner compartment walls don't hold up forever. Typically, the top and bottom walls are the first to give way, and so decay spreads quickest in the vertical direction. But luckily, the tree does have one more defense up its trunk. Remember how those dying cells of the heartwood release chemicals that make them stronger, but also discolor them? Well, the dying cells around the tap hole do the same thing. But the chemicals are also toxic to many forms of fungus. So as the decay slowly breaks down the walls and infects neighboring compartments, the surrounding wood also becomes a less hospitable environment for the fungus to grow. So assuming the wound was small enough and the infection was weak enough, by the time the cambium seals off the opening, the tree will have isolated the decay to a collection of discolored compartments. And this is why maple trees that have been tapped throughout their lives tend to produce such attractive grain patterns in their lumber. The darker wood is actually the result of spreading decay and the tree's chemical response. But that's not the only lasting reminder of maple syrup production. Because again, the tree can't fill in the tap hole. It can only ever cover it up. Eventually, the new growth rings will add plenty of strength to the tree, and after a few years, it'll hardly even be noticed. But inside the trunk, that cavity will still remain. Forever. So, with all of this in mind, I think we're finally prepared to address the question, does collecting maple sap hurt the tree? And honestly, I think the answer is a pretty definitive yes. But luckily, it's also usually an injury that the tree can readily recover from. And that's why it's so important to follow some basic precautions, like using a clean, sharp drill bit, not drilling the holes too deep, and using smaller diameter spiles when possible. Plus, you should also space new holes at least 6 inches away from the previous ones, and make sure that your tree is even large enough to support tap holes in the first place. Because when done properly, a maple tree can be tapped yearly for decades. But if done carelessly, it can result in irreparable damage and even the death of the entire plant. So while we'll continue tapping the maple trees on our property, now that we know more about the true impacts, I think we'll also do so a little less frivolously in the future. But in the meantime, thanks for watching, and we'll see you soon.